This is week three in our Advent series. We're still walking through the Gospel of Mark. We'll pick that back up when we come back in January. But the Lord had put this four-week series on my heart around the end of November. And I was like, well, I sure wish you'd give me a little more time. But the way the Holy Spirit works, He gave me the information and the inspiration. And the last 2 weeks has been fun. And this week, as I'm praying over, it's the notification the angels are giving to Zacharias and Elizabeth. And then last week was Joseph and Mary. And this week is to the shepherds. And I started thinking about patterns and transitions of change in our life. And, you know, I've shared it with you before that I was in year 26 of a law enforcement career. I was a chief of police. And I had a contract for four more years for a full 30-year pension. And I had it made. I literally did. I had a full fat cat pension waiting for me. And all I had to do was just show up most of the time. And, you know, the Lord called me to retire. And I did, immediately. 2 weeks later, I was a civilian for the first time in my adult life. And Lee and I were moving from South Louisiana to Texas. And, you know, at that time, I think I was caught off guard. It kind of came out of nowhere. And, you know, despite that, I realized that even though I didn't know where I was going, what was important was that I knew who called me to go where it was. And then as the years went by, I looked back and I realized, you know, it really wasn't out of nowhere. It wasn't out of the blue. The Lord had been giving me signs through the years leading up to that point. But of course, like anything, when you're caught in the middle, you just think, oh my gosh, like things are out of control. Where did this come from? But with hindsight, you're able to look back a little bit and you realize the Lord's got a good plan for your life. The Lord is always giving you good words and dropping hints and clues and signs. If we're just willing to get alone, get quiet, and get plugged in, you really start to see that it's not out of the blue. It didn't just happen. You look back, you start seeing the signs. You know, that's the one thing that the Lord put on my heart to share with you today. It's that God's good news brings change. And that's good news for everybody, from shepherds to kings alike. You know, what's important is that if you pay attention to the signs of the changing seasons, it keeps you ahead of what the world thinks is coming. The world's based on their opinion and social media, but you need to base your life and what's coming in your life on the word of the Lord. If you want to stay a step ahead of the world, you stick to the word. So let's stand together and read that word that gives us that direction. And this is from Luke 2, 8 through 14, and we'll read together as a body. Now, there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you in the day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." Thank you, Lord. What a good word. What a good word. So as I said, this third week in our Advent series is about patterns, shifting seasons. And you know what was fun was as I was going through the series, now I tell you, I didn't look it up or say, hey, you know, I didn't Google or like, hey, I need an Advent series. The Holy Spirit was like, if you trust me, I'm going to lead you through a four-week series. And I'm digging it. I'm like, let's do it. So week one was the single act of the angel telling Zacharias and Elizabeth that they were gonna bear a son, which was John the Baptist. So that's the first week was just a single act. Last week created a pair of acts when the angel appeared to Mary and said, "You're going to bear a son." So what creates a pattern is a steady progression of consistent actions. So in week three, the angel appears to the shepherds. and makes the same announcement. So now we're looking, and love of quantitative statistics, you start to realize that you get one set of data, and that's a single act, and enough data creates a data set and a pattern. And I know that's not interesting to you, but it's interesting to me because I do enjoy data. But you know, we start to see a pattern. Nothing's random. Angels didn't just come over here and show up over there. And there's a pattern that's being established because there's a change that's a coming. We're moving from the state of law to a state of grace. This is what the Lord's preparing us. Remember, let me set the backdrop. Before the angel Gabriel had appeared to Zacharias in the temple, remember, it had been 400 years. 400 years, and that's documented in the book of Malachi, since the Lord had spoken to his people. Now the Lord is establishing a pattern because the season's changing. So why did he appear to Zacharias and Mary and now the shepherds? Well, it's the passing of one season for the promise of another. Like I said, we are experiencing the transition from conviction of law to the salvation of grace. Now, this is an equipping church. And what I want to share with you, church, is that you move through seasons of life. You have to. If you're alive, you have to change. From birth to where you are today, you've gone through a lot of seasons of transition. When you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you went from a darkness to light, that required seasons of transition. My goodness, today's December 17th. Think back to just December 17th, 2022. From that day a year ago to today, how your life has changed. The seasons of transition. The only thing constant in this life is change. You know, even in Matthew 24, Jesus gives specifics. It's the signs of the time, of the end of the age. Everybody's always asking, are we in the end times? Are we in the end times? I will tell you, yes, we are in the end times. Every second you live, you're 1 second closer to the end of this age. And how do we know that when we're getting closer and closer? Jesus tells us in Matthew, look at the signs of the times. I want to tell you how to use those signs and seasons to guide your life. The first thing I suggest you do is you weigh the world's opinion by God's truth. You get too wrapped up in social media and mainstream media and all the prognosticators. And you know, you watch the media, no one ever gives a conclusion. This happened to so-and-so, and this is what happened, and this is what's going to happen. If this, then that. What they do is they give their opinion, and they make these predictions. And of course, the media never has to follow through and say, I was wrong. Because that's the spin of the news cycle. But what I want the body to do, and what we do, is weigh the world's opinion by God's truth. I want you to watch the signs that affect the world being affected. Oh, woe is me, woe is me. This is happening over here, and it's happening over there. That's the truth. Look to God's word to see what it says about that. Don't be so swayed. Don't be so wishy and washy, like waves tossed about with every news cycle or every social media post or everybody's opinion. Look at what's being affected, and then look at the word of the Lord that creates the effect that lasts. You know, the world predicts, the word prophesies. Every time we go back to the Old Testament to verify, validate, confirm what we're talking about in the New Testament, this is what the Old Testament was given to us for. It's an anchor, it's security, it's prophecy. Don't get wrapped up in the predictions of the world. My goodness, when people start talking about things, I'm like, who's going to win the Super Bowl? I have no idea. Right, it's a game. It is a game that's played, and you can't even predict a game. Yet you're going to predict by worldly standards what's to come in somebody's life? No, stick to the word. And I suggest that we read the Bible. before we crack open our phones and look at mainstream media. I tell you, I'm so proud and kind of jealous of our daughter Ellie, who leads worship. This is a 20-year-old college student. And we're like, hey, did you see so-and-so on social media? I don't have social media. What? You're 20 years old. You're supposed to. She goes, it takes me away from my Bible reading. And then Leah and I are like, yeah, us too. I was just joking about those cat videos. Good going, Ellie. You see this Advent series? It illustrates a pattern. Like I said, and it was such a revelation to me this week, praying over this message, that this is a time that we're experiencing through this Advent series, that we're going from this law, the state of law, to a state of grace. Zechariah, he represented the law and the sacrifices to atone for sin. Mary represented the new season of grace with the birth of the Savior. The shepherds, they represent the transition from sacrificing lambs to the final lamb to be sacrificed, who is Jesus. So let's look at the people and the patterns that we call the characters of Christmas. Zacharias and Elizabeth, we talked about them in week one. You know, Zacharias is actually, he was a temple priest. He and Elizabeth were both from the line, the Levitical line of priests. And for them to continue the line of priests required that they had a child, a son, to become a temple priest. And they were old in age, and she was barren. They carried the shame of their culture that she was not able to continue the lineage, the line of the Levitical temple priests. And the Lord Gabriel appeared to him when he was in the temple to do his duty. And I always laugh about that. I'm like, it's been 400 years since anyone's heard from the Lord. And here's Zacharias, who loves the Lord and says they were righteous and blameless before the Lord. And he walks into the temple, probably like we do a lot of Sundays, like I'm just going to show up, I'm going to do my little time, and then I'm going to go home, or I'm going to go down to Ellis County Barbecue. And bam, there is an angel of the Lord Gabriel. He had an encounter with the Lord that I pray that we have every time we come into the presence of the Lord, that we come with an expectation to have an encounter with the Lord. And the Lord told him that they were going to have this child. And this child was John the Baptist. Do you realize that they carried the cultural shame, the reproach, as Elizabeth said. They carried the cultural shame for all these years, because they did not think that they were going to continue the lineage of the Levitical priests. Yet, when they gave birth to John the Baptist, he was the last Levitical priest of the Old Covenant agreement. He was the last Old Covenant priest to come and preach repentance under conviction of the law. That repentance still required the blood sacrifice of animals. You see, what John the Baptist was doing, he was preparing the way for the new way, Jesus Christ. John 1:29 tells us, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Our second couple that we talked about last week is Mary and Joseph. They were both innocent and blameless before the Lord. Mary gave birth to the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus was the final, perfect blood sacrifice to cover all the sins of the world, past, current, and future. You know, 1 Peter 3:18 tells us, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring to us God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. What I want to tell you, that little kid song that Mary had a little lamb, Mary did have a little lamb. Jesus Christ was that lamb. But I want to tell you that Mary was also a little lamb. You see, she lived a life that was holy and set apart. I encourage you to live a Romans 12:1 life. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God, because all he has done for you, let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. I encourage you to make your lives a living sacrifice. I encourage you to live a life like Mary lived. But you see, because Mary was also a little lamb. By Mary being pregnant and unmarried, Mary could have found herself sacrificed under the law. But you know what? Even at risk to himself, her righteous betrothed husband, Joseph, a man of the law, showed mercy and grace. You see, this was the transition from the law. Had he followed Joseph the law, he would have put his Mary out there in front of the public to be condemned by the law. But instead, he showed this girl mercy and grace, because we were moving into a season of mercy and grace by the birth of the Christ. And you know, because she was righteous and he was merciful, they birthed the gift of Jesus Christ that you get to receive today. That you receive today. And this is a gift. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." I want you to think about the gift of Jesus Christ. You know, the value of the gift is often the way that we treat the gift giver. Lee and I teach this in our marriage classes. One spouse will say, "Oh, my spouse is a gift. My spouse is a gift from the Lord." Well, then why are you treating them so poorly? Why are you treating them so poorly? If Jesus is just a genie in a bottle or an afterthought when you ain't got nothing left, that reflects the way we feel about the gift giver. Let Jesus be as real an encounter as Angel Gabriel was on that day in the temple. What I want to tell you is an equipping moment that the law cannot save you. John the Baptist cannot save you. The Virgin Mary cannot save you. You cannot save you. There's only one way. And as Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So today's focus in our week 3 series, our Advent series on the characters of Christmas, I want to look at the shepherds. And I'm going to tell you what, probably most of y'all, like, this was such a new revelation to me that I had a great, great week studying and learning and really receiving the revelation of the Lord. And Luke 2:8, I want to dig into this. And it says, Luke 2:8, "Now there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night." So it's like, well, who are these shepherds? I mean, did he just like randomly pick some guys out there? What I want to tell you is Luke 2:8 says, "Now they were in the same country." So what country is that? Well, that's Bethlehem. So they were in the location of Bethlehem. Shepherds living out in the fields. Okay, what fields? Well, I want to tell you, the Mishnah it's a Greek book. It's a Greek word. So we've been talking about in the Gospel of Mark that you have the law, the first five books, the Torah, the Pentateuch. The Torah is the Hebrew word for the first five books, and the Pentateuch is the Greek word for the five books, penta meaning five. So that's the law. We've talked about that in the Gospel of Mark leading up to this series. And then you have the oral traditions. Remember, that's where Jesus was trying to correct the Pharisees. You're so wrapped up in your oral traditions that you've forgotten the love of the Lord and the law. So the Mishnah is what that is they started to document all these oral traditions. I mean, if you can imagine how hard it is to keep track. Like at our house on the holidays, when Leah breaks out a whiteboard and starts making a list, that means work for everybody else. But we know she's keeping track of what's got to be done. This is the Mishnah. This is a Hebrew book that is written to document the oral traditions. Now, in this book, it's called the Mishnah Bava Kamma. It's 7:7. And what it says is, it's the law. It says, "Small domesticated animals, such as sheep and goats, could not be raised in settled areas because they graze on other people's crops." So what I want to tell you is when you're like, well, these shepherds are in the area, why do they get to be in the area? Because the Mishnah says they cannot be in the area because they eat everybody's flocks. Well, the Mishnah also tells us that the only exception, the only flocks otherwise kept, were those kept for temple services. What I want to tell you is the shepherds that were close in Bethlehem, they were there because they were raising the sheep for temple sacrifice. You see, the priests in the temple, they didn't raise sheep. They had to outsource their supply of lambs to be sacrificed to the Lord. So these shepherds, when we're talking about shepherds in a field, we're not just talking about a random group of dudes, a bunch of gypsies with some livestock. These are very specific shepherds who are in a region authorized by Jewish law for the purpose of raising lambs for what? Sacrifice. Because we're still under the law. You see, even their location was prophesied in the Old Testament. We go to Micah 4:8, and it says, "And thou, O tower of the flock, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion, unto thee shall it come, even the first dominion, the kingdom shall come to the daughter of Jerusalem." What I want to tell you is right next to Bethlehem, it's called the Shepherd's Field. It's actually a field called the Shepherd's Field, where they did what? Where they raised lambs. You know what's in that field? It's called the Migdal Eder. And it's a Hebrew word. Migdal means tower. Eder means herd of flock. In Hebrew, it means tower of the flock. You see, there's nothing random about the birth of Christ. There's nothing random about God's plan in your life. There's nothing random about the selections he makes, the people he calls. He's called every one of us. He's waiting for us to accept the calling. When we receive the calling, he gives you the anointing. But he's waiting for you to develop the character to carry that anointing. You see, all of this, it's not just a random group of gypsies raising livestock. This is prophesied in the Old Testament. These shepherds are specifically trained, assigned to raise perfect, unblemished lambs for temple sacrifice. So we say, well, why a tower? Luke 2:8, keeping watch over their flock by night. You see, in tactical terms, in law enforcement and military, overwatch, it's a position where you take a high level, a high area, and you overwatch your troops. You overwatch to see the enemy. These shepherds are in an overwatch position. Where do you get up to watch over? In the tower. And what are you watching for? Well, you're watching for wolves and thieves. Like these shepherds, you watch the kids shows and they're jolly and they got a little campfire going and somebody's probably got some beef jerky or something. And these guys are on active duty. Like this is serious business. You know, the Apostle Paul, when he's given orders to the elders at the church of Ephesus, this is how serious the business of shepherding is. And he tells us in Acts 20, so guard yourselves and God's people. Feed and shepherd God's flock, his church, purchased with his own blood, over which the Holy Spirit has appointed you as leaders. I know that false teachers, like vicious wolves, will come in among you after I leave, not sparing the flock. Even some men from your own group will rise up and distort the truth in order to draw a following. Watch out! Remember the 3 years I was with you, my constant watch, and care over you night and day, and my many tears for you. And now I entrust you to God and the message of his grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance with all those he has set apart for himself. Like shepherding is serious business. These shepherds took this serious. These shepherds' only responsibility are to raise perfect, unblemished sheep to be slaughtered, to be sacrificed. You see, I want to repeat, nothing is random with God's plan for your life. If you've got a heart to know what's going on in your life or what's about to happen in your life, I'm asking you, go to the Word of the Lord. Go to the Word of the Lord. These shepherds didn't just find a tower in an empty field. This was prophesied in the Old Testament. The where, the what, the how to overwatch. Like God doesn't want us running around like rats in a maze sniffing cheese. God wants you with clarity, with specificity, with direction. And if you're struggling with that, well, I just don't know. I don't hear from him. It ain't because he's not talking to you. It ain't because he's not talking to you. I want you to start looking for those roadblocks, looking for those walls put up, those false walls in the maze that's blocking you from getting your cheese. The Lord has not abandoned you. The Lord is waiting for you, patiently waiting for you. Go to the word of the Lord and read the word of the Lord. And look, don't neglect the Old Testament. There's some folks that are like, oh, that's old stuff. That's done. That ain't done. From the beginning to the end, it is all Jesus. You go to the Old Testament, and let me tell you, there's a blessing that comes from meditating on the Old Testament. Joshua 1:8 tells us, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate it in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have a good success. What I want to encourage you is the word of the Lord is not a salad bar. You cannot pick and choose the parts you like and the parts you don't. When I meet new believers and they're like, we're going to start in Genesis. Great. Come see me at about chapter 3. Maybe chapter 4. And good luck with Deuteronomy and Leviticus and Numbers. But get through it. What I want to tell you, let's talk a little bit about temple sacrifice and worship. Again, the Mishnah, which is the Jewish recording of all the laws, the oral laws, it describes the process for worship and sacrifice that's given in the Torah. You see, the lamb was designated as an acceptable sacrifice for the atonement of sin because it was seen as innocent. It was innocent. Like the lamb is innocent. It's not, it has no defense mechanisms. It's not a predator. It is absolutely, completely defenseless. It is absolutely, completely dependent upon the care of a shepherd. This is why when I tell you these shepherds, it was serious business. It was serious business. A ravenous wolf or a flock of thieves, they could destroy a flock in no time. No different than what they can do to a church today. You've got to stand guard. You've got to stand guard. You see, the temple priests, like we said, they didn't raise livestock. Their job was to take, and they were ministering at the altar of the Lord, and they were to prepare the sacrifices. So they had to outsource their supply of lambs. And this is why these particular shepherds that are mentioned in Luke, and they're able to be within the city limits, so to speak, of Bethlehem, and they had a designated field because the tower of Migdal Eger was prophesied. Everything is purposeful and intentional. But you know the crazy part? Is these shepherds, they were forbidden according to the Mishnah. The Mishnah actually says, if you find a shepherd in a ditch, leave him. Leave him. They were looked at as dirty and filthy because they lived out in the field. They weren't even allowed to come into the temple to worship the Lord by the religious leaders. What I want to tell you, church, let's make sure we don't forbid people from coming into the house of the Lord. That we get too religious. We get too rule-oriented. What I want to tell you, these shepherds were intentionally selected. They were called. They were trained. They had the character. They knew their job. And the beauty, you know, the word shepherd in the Greek is poimen. And it's one who tends flocks, who guards, and it also means pastor. Now, in Ephesians 4:11, when Jesus is talking about the gifts that he gives to the church, is that he uses the word shepherd or pastor. It's really the only time that it's used in the New Testament. So these shepherds who are raising the lambs, they're actually pastors in our today's world. You see, that's the noun verb. That's the noun form of the Greek. The verb form in Greek for pastor is poimenio, and that means to feed. It's a shepherd, pastor's job, to feed. To feed what? Well, the Greek word for flock is poimi, and it means a flock or a flock of disciples. See, this is a shepherd's job, is to feed, to water, to make them lay down in green grass, to protect them, to guide them, to lead them into worship before the Lord. You see, it's a pastor's job. And I don't mean pastor like the dude up here on Sunday with a microphone on his face. I mean the people who minister, the people who love the body of Christ. It's our job to lead, to raise up godly people, to lead in ungodly times. You know why? Because the seasons are changing. You can sit on your thumbs and hope nothing bad happens on the outside. But I'm going to tell you that times are changing. And it's time, particularly, to raise up godly men to lead their families in ungodly times. It's time to raise up godly families to lead in ungodly times. You see, these shepherds, their time as natural shepherds was coming to an end because a supernatural good shepherd was being born. Luke 2:11 tells us, "For until you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." See, these shepherds knew the Old Testament. They knew the Torah. They knew the first five books. They knew the minor and major prophets in the Old Testament. So when the angel gives them this word, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord," they knew what that meant for them. Basically, what this angel is telling them, "Hey guys, you're going to be out of a job soon. Times are changing." And who better than to tell, right? Who better than to tell first than these shepherds? These shepherds have committed their lives to raising the very lambs that are to be sacrificed in the temple before the Lord. Why not tell these guys first? Like I said, it's basically a job notification. Hey, the Savior's been born. We're shifting seasons from law to grace. And so what did these shepherds do with the changing of season? They realized that it was the fulfillment of a prophecy. Luke 2:20 tells us, "Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told to them." Like, these guys know the mission. They know the assignment. They're ready for it. They're in the middle of it. And they're ready to carry it through. You know, what was also important was, why these shepherds? Why not the shepherds down the road? Because God is intentional and specific in all that he does. You see, these shepherds were skilled at doing what? At inspecting these lambs. They would inspect them. They would ensure that they were perfect and spotless. And only those lambs were brought forth for worship before the Lord. Luke 2:17 tells us, "Now when they had seen him," talking about the shepherds seeing the babe, "they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child." The word "known" in the Greek means to declare. When these purposely chosen shepherds were called to see the babe, they had an eye that could inspect to know that it is blameless and it is perfect for sacrifice before the Lord. When they saw this child, Luke 2:17 tells us that they declared, that they verified, they certified the perfect, the innocent, the unblemished Lamb of God. It wasn't just a random group of people walking by a store window on Christmas. They were specifically called. You are specifically called. You see, they raised unblemished lambs for sacrifice. Who better to verify that sacrifice was perfect? You know, also, as they understood, their changing of seasons meant that, like I said, they would soon be out of a job because the good shepherd had been born. John 10 tells us, and this is Jesus, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he's a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay my life down for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them I also must bring. And they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father." See, Jesus knows his assignment. I want you to know your assignment. I want you to know your calling. I want you to know that nothing's random. Faith, if you want to come up. I want you to see that there's patterns in this season. I want you to understand that there's patterns in your life. Things change. They have to. They have to. There's no neutral. Everything alive is either living or dying. You have control over that. You have knowledge over that. You have information over that. It is found in the Word. What I want to ask, are you in a season? Has God made an announcement to you in your life? Have you received a prophetic word over the calling in your life? Are you at the start of a new season in life? Because it's fresh, it's exciting, it's new. I got a prophetic word. Amen. Lee and I were so excited when the Lord called us to plant a church years ago. And then it got real. But it was still beautiful because it was from the Lord. What I want to tell you is if you're in a fresh season of transition, it could be scary. It could be hectic. It could be chaotic. Go back to the word of the Lord. Go back to God and ask specific questions. Are you in the chaotic middle of a new season of life? And it's not just a ministry calling. We've got some folks in here that are just married. Thank you, Jesus, for their commitment to a covenant marriage before the Lord. Marriage, woohoo! About a week later, this is it. This is who I married. Look to the word of the Lord. And are you coming at the end, at the swirl of a major life change? You know, a lot of times things don't look like what we think they're going to look like because we set our own expectation over what we think it's supposed to look like. If you want to know what the Lord wants it to look like, go to the word of the Lord and ask him what it's supposed to look like. A lot of times our disappointments come from unrealistic expectations that are unmet. You see, the truth is God is leading your path. Matter of fact, God's laid your path out before you, straight and smooth. But it's, are you going to follow that path? Is it a path that you want to choose? The beauty, because God loves you so much, is God gives you choice to follow that path or not. So I just want to tell you that the birth of Christ allows you to live in this season of grace. Grace only comes from Jesus Christ. There's no other way. I want to ask if you've embraced Jesus Christ. Even if you've received him and then walked away from him because his plan wasn't elevating fast enough. Maybe some of those shepherds were like, yeah, I dig it. Like our whole job was to raise these lambs for the sacrifice, but I kind of like raising these lambs. I like the status that being a shepherd gives me. So now what, Jesus is going to be born and I'm going to be out of a job? You mean we're going into a season of grace where there's not going to be any more lambs being sacrificed? No, I don't know if I like that or not. See, we find ourselves in those situations. I'll tell you, when I was a chief of police, I liked being a chief of police. I liked the status it gave me. I liked the way that people catered to me. I liked the way that I drove through town going to Dairy Queen to get a blizzard late at night and people would slow down and they would stop at stop signs. All I'm thinking about is that what topping am I going to get on my blizzard? I like that, you see? And the Lord knew I liked that. When he called me away, I didn't know who I was. I knew what I did. I had to learn whose I was, that my status didn't come from a badge, that my calling came from a cross. I want to ask you right now, if you're in a season of your life where your status comes from anything other than the cross, I want to ask, are you willing to lay it down? Are you willing to take what you've assumed are those earthly crowns and lay them on the ground? I want to ask, are you willing to pick up the cross? If we can stand as the body, and I'll ask our altar ministry team to come up. And this has really been it's a beautiful season of transition. So whatever's going on in your life, And I know the Holy Spirit's talking to some of y'all. I am going to encourage you to not hesitate. I'm going to encourage you to come up and ask for prayer. I'm going to encourage you to not let anything of this world keep you from coming up and not receiving an encounter with the living God. I want to encourage you to keep the important thing important, and that's King Jesus. If we can, I want to pray this blessing over you. And we're going to continue this time of ministry. I ask that you come up. If you've not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is the day. If you have not been living your life for the Lord, if being a chief of police or being a boss or being a shepherd or being anything else has been more important than being a child of God, I'm going to ask you to lay that down at the cross today. I'm going to ask you to come up, and I'm asking you to a prophetic act of laying whatever it is that keeps you apart from Christ or separates yourself from Christ, to lay it down at the foot of the cross. I want to pray this prayer over you, and it comes from the Old Testament, from Psalm 34. If you will close our eyes, not to be weird, but just to create some intimacy, because I don't want the peripheral to be a distraction to you. And I want to pray this prayer over you. I'm going to pray the word of the Lord over you. And it says, I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. Church, what I want to tell you today, and the Holy Spirit's asked me to park right here, there is someone here that needs to cry out. You need to cry out to the Lord. You need to drop your attitude, your ego, your pride. You need to stop worrying about what your wife is going to say or what your wife is going to think. And you need to cry out to the Lord. This is the only way the Lord's going to save you from your troubles. I know your job's in jeopardy. I know your marriage is in jeopardy, because the Holy Spirit's taught me. I'm asking you. Let this be your encounter with the Lord. If you're willing to save your marriage, I'm asking you to make that profession today. I'm asking you to cry out to the Lord. God's word said that he saved him out of all his troubles. Brother, I'm asking you today, because the Lord has put you on my heart, and I won't call you by name, but your marriage is in trouble, and you know this. I'm asking you to call out. He will save you of your troubles, because the angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Dear Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this word. We thank you for the reality that nothing is random, that nothing is coincidence, that there's no such thing as karma in the kingdom, that there's no such thing as luck with the Lord, that it is all intentional and it is purposeful and it is by design, and it began with Genesis 1:1 and it continues. Lord, I pray that this body taps in to the goodness of God, to the promise of God, to the eternal knowledge and the deep things of the Lord that only come through the Holy Spirit. I pray that as we move into the season of Christmas, that no matter what's going on in our lives, that we keep the important thing, and that's King Jesus. And I want to declare right now, I'm going to cast out depression. I'm going to cast out fear. I'm going to cast out debt. I know right now the joy of the Lord is third in your life, because number one is the money that you owe that you don't have. I cast it out in the name of Jesus. I cast out debt and I cast out fear in the name of Jesus. 2 Timothy 1 tells us, I did not give you a spirit of fear. I did not give you a spirit of fear. If you've got fear or anxiety or worry or doubt or hesitation, that didn't come from the Lord. It didn't come from the Lord. He didn't give it to you. He gave you love. He gave you power. He gave you a sound mind. I cast it out in the name of Jesus. I've still got a burden on my heart for the marriage that's struggling right now. I want to cast out pride, lust, perversion. I'm only saying what the Holy Spirit's saying. I cast it out in Jesus' name. I replace the darkness. I replace it with truth, transparency, honesty. I replace it with the light of Jesus Christ. I pray this in Jesus' name. So, Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We praise you, Lord, for the movement in the presence of the Holy Spirit. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. I pray a covering over this body, over the families here, over the families that couldn't be here, for the families that are going to be here. Lord, I pray a covering and a blessing. Lord, we love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. We'll keep the altar ministry up, but bodies dismiss. God bless you.